Hello, everyone. So I'm here in Gothenburg with Johan Carlson recording the podcast, but he was also kind enough to show us the SSRF in GitLab that he exploited in a very clever way. It's not the typical full read SSRF where you just read the metadata and you have the impact. It's the one when he actually had to work hard to get the critical impact and the good payout. And he will walk us through the bug today. So enjoy the video. Can you tell us, please, what's the functionality where the bug started?
So this bug was in a fairly new functionality that was, they called it analytic dashboards. It's sort of like a third-party integration thing where you could get data and send data to an analytic service that would monitor how your application is used, sort of.
And that's something that you configure as a URL, as a third-party website, right?
Yeah, exactly. So, and for the context of this bug a bit later, I think that originally you configured this as an administrator on the platform. So you configured a set of an analytic dashboard set of features that GitLab also provides as a Docker, or not a Docker, even worse, like a Kubernetes cluster thing. So you provide it with like four different URLs to four different services running inside of this Kubernetes cluster on different ports and stuff like that. What I found then was that all of these were in different ways suspect to SSRF, but only one of them were like a full read where you can actually get the error back. The other ones were blind and like semi-blind and really blind.
Yeah. How did it happen that one of them returned the body?
Yeah, that was when you look at the source code, it was just like one of them had just that it was trying to treat whatever it got back as JSON, and they had a not their like general error message when things break. They just sent you back whatever the JSON parsing did.
Okay.
So you got back like an error, like we cannot parse this, and then you got like this giant payload back.
Yeah, at the best. And so how did you show the impact of this?
Yeah, so I think it's the reason why I chose to highlight this bug because I think it proves how you can gain higher impact by knowing your target. And in this particular case, this bug went from, I reported this as high because I had a full read and I thought that that's usually a high, or it at least could be. And then it got, I managed to first move it to critical and then it get pushed down to medium again. And then I, through some fighting, got it back to critical again.
Yeah, it was a long read.
Yeah, it was a long ride. So the idea here was that I could get a full read both on my internal or like my self-hosted instance, but also on the prod instance, where I could actually like poke around in whatever they have in their infrastructure. I didn't really find anything super sensitive. They have had one critical SSRF in the past, which was this Grafana SSRF thing, where I think that Justin managed to actually show some real impact in the production, at least poke at some real systems there. And I think they've hardened it quite a lot since then. So I focused a bit more on my self-hosted instance.
Yeah.
How
does GitLab rate the severity, more based on their GitLab common instance or the self-hosted one? Which is the most important one?
No, it's actually the same. You can get the highest bounty both for the self-hosted and the .com one. You just have to prove that it's not something that you have to like misconfigure, then it might be lowered even for the. So in this case, I wanted to show like if you just install it normally, using their like the packaged version they have. And if I just install it and I could trigger this and it could get like a critical impact, then that's enough to get a full critical on GitLab as well.
So that, how did you achieve this?
Yeah, so I started to look at different services that are... So when you install GitLab locally or as a Docker instance, they spin up a bunch of services that they actually list in their documentation, like all the ports where things are running. So you don't really have to do any scanning or whatever. You can just try it out and see if any of them have something interesting to use. So I looked at that list, and I also tried to read all of the old SSRF reports I could find from GitLab. And I didn't find anything that managed to put it higher than a high, essentially. But I did find, which I think you kind of corrected me before here, but someone has collected like a list of blind SSRF.
Yeah, the asset nodes blind SSRF chain repo on GitHub. Yeah.
So on that list, there's actually like a small SSRF gadget from GitLab where they mention the Redis exporter, which is a small tool that is used by, I think it's used by Prometheus to gain like statistics to show you about your instance. And this Redis exporter has a path that is called slash scrape. And then you can give it a URL as a query parameter.
Yeah.
And in the old asset note list, they just show you that you can point it to an IP address of the Redis instance, and then you can get like keys and values from the Redis instance back.
Oh, so it's like designed to pull things out of the Redis instance.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it's quite different from the other. They have a lot of exporters. But usually, because Prometheus is supposed to show like metadata and statistics and stuff like that, so usually they don't contain anything sensitive, the things that you can export. But this Redis exporter is a bit different because it gives you keys and values, and that's sort of what you use Redis for. You store these keys and values in there, and potentially they could be dangerous, then, was my thought. But it happened now that... Nowadays, apparently, they are not exposing Redis on an IP anymore. I guess they used to do it when AssetNote found this gadget. But what I found out was that this Redis exporter also could work with Unix sockets.
Yeah.
Which is, if you're... I'm not like a low-level network hacker, but a Unix socket is some sort of network... low-level piece.
It's something I didn't know you can talk to when you have the SSRF, that's for sure.
No. And I guess you cannot really do it usually from like a web context, but this exporter is built in a way that it can talk to Redis through a socket as well. Because Redis is also talking this really low-level TCP language. Which also... Previously, you could get RCE just by talking to a Redis through HTTP, but they have removed that exploitation vector as well. No, but so I figured out that I could point to this Redis instance, and then you could also, when you give it this URL, you could also give it another parameter that limits sort of what you search for. So you can search for a word and put a star in, and you can like search for different keys in the Redis instance. And at that point, I thought it was high again, because you can get data, but I don't really know what they store in Redis in GitLab. So I wanted to find something juicy in there. So I started, you can also then, when you host your own GitLab instance, you can monitor, so you can log into the instance through SSH, and you can start monitoring the logs from Redis. And I just started like tailing and grepping through the logs while using GitLab to see if like something interesting. So I like created tokens, like connected some tokens to my account and stuff like that to see if something of it like ended up in Redis. And I got some hits. Some were like ephemeral, I guess. Like you could see them for like a really short period and then they disappeared.
Yeah.
So that could be something you could report, I guess. And then I also found that you could get like SSRF, no, CSRF tokens,
CSRF tokens.
For all sessions. So you could get the IP and the CSRF token that is connected to that session.
Yeah.
So you could sort of scrape all of the CSRF tokens and then make a POC page where you match the IP who's coming in.
Is in GitLab CSRF token enough to get the CSRF?
Because the cookies are none.
Oh, that's very kind.
So, I mean, that vector could be abused as well.
Yeah.
So I kind of wrote that first, but that's also not really critical because you have to have a lot of user interaction.
Yeah. Like that. And also you would have to have a JavaScript code
that
would match the IP of the CSRF token and hope it's
enough. it's a bit complex. Complex. But then eventually I stumbled on to something because I was like going through all of the tokens and stuff in my head, like sensitive things that you can do with GitLab. And then I tried out creating and connecting a GitLab runner. And the GitLab runner is when you're working on GitLab or GitHub or anything else, you have this concept of like storing your code, but then you also have the concept of running pipelines or like build jobs or all of these other like CI, CD, DevOps things.
Yeah.
And those, the context of GitLab, these are running on separate servers that are called runners. And a runner is registered with the token. And then when the runner is idle, it will start like polling the GitLab instance, like I'm ready for work. And then if someone has a project that is connected to this runner and they have a job, they will say like, this is my new job.
Yeah.
And the runner will say like, okay, I take that job. It will pull the session and it can pull the code and it will run the code and do the all the CI things.
So the runner authenticates using the token.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, okay.
And it starts like picking jobs using that. And then the idea is that you shouldn't really need to care which runner you are using. Like they are like the same if you have like allowed them to be used in your project.
Yeah.
So what I found then was quite interesting was that they actually used that token as a part of the ID in the key value in Redis.
Yeah.
So that was stored like indefinitely for what I could see. So you could actually like ask for the beginning of the key, which was always the same, and then you would put a star there.
Yeah.
And then you would get a list of like all the runner tokens on the instance. And using these runner tokens, you could then create your own runner, connect to the GitLab instance and say like, okay, I want all of these jobs.
Yeah, so there was no sort of IP validation of the runners. It was just any runner.
No, at least not like in a base scenario. And this is also something they warn about in the documentation. They say like, this token is supposed to be secret because if you find it, you will be able to impersonate the runner and run jobs.
Yeah.
And what that sort of creates in the end is actually RCE then in all of the runner jobs on the GitLab instance.
Yeah, because runner has access to all the source code.
Yeah.
Does it have like push access as well?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, depending on what it's supposed to do, but it will definitely be, I mean, what a runner job usually does is that it builds things, it runs tests and stuff, and it might push artifacts, and it could deploy code in production or in different places. And so in a way you have like all the keys to the kingdom.
That's the best thing. How much time did it take you? Because I assume you had the SSRF and then you just spend a lot of time using different features to see if there's something sensitive in the Redis.
Yeah.
So how much time did it take for you to finally find this feature that gave you the critical?
I think I spent like a week or two. I also had
a
to
week or two. <That's a lot. laughs>
But not like full time. Just like tinkering on like thinking about new ways of exploiting. Because I also was at the same time like fighting with the triagers. So GitLab hadn't even seen the bug yet, okay. really.
Yeah.
So I just had it like in the back of my mind, like I want to exploit this more. So I just thought about different things and tested out. And so from the beginning, I actually found this through code review because they were using a feature. They were actually using a safe wrapper to send HTTP requests, which they also always use. But they had put in the flag allow local requests or something like that. And that flag is used only when they know that it's safe to do this. So I kind of assume that they first built this for the admin side of GitLab, and then they exposed it to like groups and projects to configure on their own.
Because could any user configure this?
Yeah. At the point when I found it, you could just be a regular user with your own project and you can...
So that's why it was critical, because there was no privileges required?
Yeah, they will put it as privilege required low.
But it is a self-registration, no? So this is the...
Yeah, but on the self... So they have in their scope policy, like a special edge case that they always treat... if you need an account, it will be low. And that's because... On self-hosted instances, it's not guaranteed.
Oh, because there's no always self-sign-up.
No, exactly.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah.
But the rest was like top, so that's why.
Yeah, so exactly. So then you could just go in there and you could get... I don't think that they put anything else any lower. And the scope was changed then. I guess that's part of SSRF. To begin with.
Okay.
I'm not sure. Scope is really hard to
But I guess if you have different you can leak data from Redis.
Yeah, and I mean and you're actually in the runner then, which is a separate application as well.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Cool. Nice. Congratulations for that.
Thank you.
If you enjoyed it, listen to our whole interview that will be published about 2 weeks after this bug is published. We'll talk about way more interesting things. So for now, thank you for watching and goodbye.